Good afternoon. How is everyone doing?
Good afternoon.
All right. One person in the front is very excited, so that bodes well. We're very excited to be with you today to talk about mapping your customer journey from the inside out. We're going to be sharing the presentation, so you hear a little bit from me, a little bit from Steven, and then we're going to open it up to some questions from yourselves. Some of the things that we'll be talking about today is diagnosing objectives and the gaps that might exist in your customer journey. You're also going to find out how to map and operationalize some of the processes across your customer journey, break down the stages of your engagements, and also understand key areas for focus and development. Now, one thing that we wanted to remind you about is that at the end, we'll be doing Q&A with Slido. So if you go to the Slido app, or if you go to slido.com, make sure that you put in your questions and vote so that at the end, we'll be able to get to them in order. All right, ready?
Room name is Zinc. Yeah. Just as a reminder, the room name is Zinc.
Yeah. Very important, because otherwise someone else might be answering them. All right, so who are we? I'm Jennifer York. As I said, I'm Director of Client Success for Bizarre Voice. Question for all of you. Who has shopped online somewhere other than Amazon? Excellent. You have used our product. So what we do is we do ratings and reviews and consumer-generated content. We help clients like Argos or L'Oreal collect those things, and then we help them display them on their website or put them in other places where they might sell products. So if you're L'Oreal and you sell your product at John Lewis, the review will also show up there. So that's what we do.
Yeah, my name is Steven Lewandowski. I'm from Signavio, Director of Customer Success, built up the team globally. And we're based in Berlin, so whoever's from Germany and want to talk customer success or process management, feel free to approach me, because we're a vendor of a SaaS business process management solution. And my question would be, who of you is doing process? Who has processes in their company? That's what I wanted to hear. So happy to talk to you about customer journeys. So giving back to you, Jennifer.
All right, so without further ado, at Bizarre Voice, we wanted to go through and look at our customer or client journey. And it's really important to do this at various stages over the lifetime of your company, because you're consistently growing. You might be selling to different people, and so your clients are going to change too. So what we did was we actually started to elicit feedback from our clients. We can do this in a number of ways. You can do that through interviews. We obviously run NPS. Some of you might also run NPS or surveys with your clients. There's tons of different ways to do that. But what we saw, this is actually an example of some of the feedback that we had gotten that prompted us to say, you know what, there's something here that we need to look into, because we were getting a lot of comments on the negative side about service. And so that's what prompted us to get together a group of individuals across the organization to actually look into this issue. So the first thing is simply just elicit feedback. Find out if there's actually a problem big enough or an opportunity big enough to warrant putting the work in. The next thing you want to do is you want to think about what you're actually trying to accomplish. So client journey, there's many different things that you can do and many different ways to look at the issue. And so you really need to define what it is that you're trying to accomplish so that you don't end up with a project that has so much scope it never ends. And so for us, what we really wanted to think about was when we're wanting to have a client who's successful, at the end of the day, a successful client will stay with us. So we wanted to ensure that somebody who was going to stay with us or renew, that they were getting the value of the product or the software as quickly as possible. Because the faster they got that, the more time they had to actually experience the value of the product before they renewed. So the first one was actually decreasing customer time to value. The next one was actually resolving some of the roles, activities, and outcomes across the journey. And so we had a couple of situations where we had different handoffs between teams, and it was very unclear as to who the owner was. And so you would have a client in implementation where they would have a question of a semi-technical nature, and you would have a consultant, you would have a CSM or a CSD as we call them, or someone from technical support. And the challenge was they would all sort of sit there and go like, I don't know who should answer that. I think it's you. Which just caused a lot of delays and not a great experience for the customer. So we wanted to resolve each of the roles and make sure they were clearly defined. We also wanted to, of course, reduce churn, because everyone likes revenue. The more revenue you have, the more opportunity there is to invest in the product, in growing the company and in finding more customers. And some other areas as well, we're looking at increased client growth and also reducing our fulfillment and operational expense. So basically thinking about how do we do more with the same amount, or the glass half empty side, how do you do more with less? So once we did that, we actually decided to start very simply. So you don't have to make this complicated. We actually, and this is an example of one of our whiteboards, so it can be really ugly, where we actually mapped out each of the different roles, the stages, and what the experience was like. And we tried to go through this as though we were a customer. If you have the opportunity, I would actually say to you, try to be a customer from the very first marketing touch point. So even before somebody would sign a contract, if you can be a fake customer in your system and go through the experience, that's even more powerful because you will find out exactly what the experience is without any sort of bias. Not everyone has that opportunity, so what we did was we sat down and got people from cross-functional teams to talk about it, and we highlighted all of the areas that worked and the areas that didn't. So once we did that, we were able to identify areas of pain for the clients and also areas of pain for us internally. So there's things that the client was experiencing that was a pain point, but the reason it was a pain point was because we internally didn't have the tools, processes, or approach that would allow us to get rid of that pain. And you need to highlight both. And so that then gives us an area of focus as to what we can fix and what we can prioritize. Again, if you try to boil the ocean, you will run into the challenge of a never-ending process. So you really need to think about the things that are going to take the most burden off of your clients and the most burden off of your team, and start with those. Once we had that, we then said, okay, what is our ideal client lifecycle? And what are the varying stages, based on all of our whiteboarding, that we're thinking about? And then we identified the team members who were involved in each of those stages, as well as the ones who were responsible for leading each of those stages. Again, because for us, one of the challenges that we had was varying team members who didn't have distinct roles, and so this was one of the ways that we could avoid that. So you can see for us, the way that we highlighted it is if it's purple, that means that that person at the end of the day is responsible at that stage for making sure that things are accomplished with the client, and then the other people that will be involved, but at the end of the day, they're not going to be held accountable. We also try to look at time frames as well, so that as clients move through this customer life cycle, we have the opportunity to say, is this functioning properly? Most of them should be within 2 months for the ongoing based on treatment model. That's how long they should be in the business strategy section. If they're below that, great. If they're far above that, then we need to diagnose that issue, because something's gone wrong. Now, once you have that, the next thing that you want to do is you actually want to create the same process and lifecycle in different versions for people across your company, because you'll have different team members that are very visual, you'll have other team members that are very detail-oriented, and you need to be able to speak to each of them so that they understand exactly what needs to happen at each of those stages. So you're probably going to have documentation for the exact same stage that looks different, and that's part of the reason why I wanted to show you these two versions. This is a version that actually we share with the members of our sales team. Because for them, they just wanted something very straightforward to understand what are the main points of the client lifecycle journey. They don't want to know the details. They shouldn't know the details. And that's part of the reason why we put this together. Then, for our very detail-oriented individuals, this is actually for our consulting organization, we went through and we created a RACI. So who is responsible at each stage, who is accountable, who is also informed, to make sure that everyone has an exact idea as to who and what is involved for each stage. Then the last thing that we did is we actually wanted to ensure that everyone understood for each stage of the life cycle what success looked like and what the tactics are for each of those stages. And so for each stage, we actually created for each role what the measures of success are, and also what the tactics they will be taking care of. With each of these together, it allowed us to give a very clear picture as to what the client lifecycle is, and allows us to also pinpoint when things go awry and need a little bit of correction. So now I'm going to hand it over to Stephen to talk a little bit about Signavio.
Thank you, Jennifer. So what you're looking at here is a simplified version of a business process. So this is not a beautified picture of something I want to show you, which kind of makes it easy to consume for somebody. This is a real business process model. So I stripped out the descriptions and the titles. So you just see activities and lines connecting them, right? Things that are happening. What I want to do in the next slides, I want to take you to basically through the steps we took in understanding our processes, our engagement models, and our customer journey in the end to actually get better processes out of that. So what we've done historically as a process management company, we had processes. So as a startup from a few employees, small, we started to map processes to understand what are we doing, who's responsible. So you see these yellow boxes, this is something that somebody is doing. These are in other boxes which show who's responsible for that. So if you would put all details into there, we would come back to RACI, for example, and would see, okay, who's responsible, who's accountable, who's informed, et cetera. So this is basically where we started. So we had a really well understanding how our processes work, who's responsible for what. We're pretty sure that we know what we're doing because we had streamlined processes, clear handovers, so everything was basically clear what we were doing. But what we then thought was, coming back to the simplification part, that you need something that's easier consumable. So looking at this, for example, which are onboarding steps, one of these examples we had, we were finally talking about engagement models. So from the processes, we went to the engagement models to really understand, okay, what do we really want to do? So in this example, the customer onboarding steps, what are really the steps that are important for the customer? So we needed to think, so as a first step towards a customer journey, what is actually interesting for the customer? What is really important for them? Which steps are important? Which timelines are important? And what is happening at these steps for the customer? So really understanding what's going on there. And this also is something we're using internally, for example, to talk to other teams like sales, for example, to consulting teams with different engagement models for different teams to really get an understanding of what are they supposed to do and what needs to be done for these steps. So just out of curiosity, how many of you are working with engagement models? So simplified models to internally educate and work with other teams. Okay, that's a little less than half, I guess. So already on a good road. And this helps very much, especially with internal education, right? If you want to educate internally, one of my teams is the actual training team who does the internal trainings. Things like that just help to train people. But I think you can never have enough of these engagement models to understand topics. And what this also helps with, it guides you, or it gives you and starts to give you understanding of things that are interesting to the customer. So for us, the process was clear. What are we doing internally to solve certain issues? But what is important is actually what the customer outcomes are. So these engagement models kind of show you and kind of guide you into the direction what those are, which lead you actually to customer journeys, which we're talking about today. And there are a few questions you should ask yourself maybe before or during you think about doing the customer journeys. So of course, how does the journey of your customers look like? So think about what your customers are actually doing with you. How does the journey look for these customers? What are the different touch points that you have with the customers? Where do they experience insecurity, frustration? So what are maybe pain points they have? Or what are like challenges they have? And how are they shown in your customer journey? And these are some questions you should ask yourself before actually approaching a customer journey, mapping a customer journey, to be really sure what should be the outcome. So some people are talking about buyer journeys, some people are talking about customer journeys. Just be sure what you want to talk about. We had a discussion earlier with Jennifer backstage where we talked about that actually it's a prospect customer journey or something like that. Really it starts in marketing, it starts early on when customers have their first touch points with the company and then later on their customers and they really see what you're doing with their company. So an example customer journey map, for example, for somebody who wants to buy some tools, very simple model here, is actually a very simplified model where you only seek like, where does the research begin? How is he really aware? How is he or she, the prospect, getting interest for your company? So where's research happening? So where do they actually have the first touch point with your company? Then where is the awareness? When do they understand, okay, there is a company that actually has what I want to do, so I'm approaching this company. Then you have a discovery phase where they might see, okay, I can buy this stuff, but maybe I need some services around that, so that's the confusion part, until they have maybe consulting parts that they want to buy and realize, okay, this company offers that as well. So really understand these key steps in this customer journey to understand what they're doing. So this is a simplified model. And there you see also some challenges, for example, when the customer is not sure if there's reasonable consulting. And if you're aware of some of these points, just knowing, okay, I'm aware of that point, and this could have influences then back on my processes. And when you look at the journey, there are certain things you should do when you have this journey set up. So when you have such a journey, make sure that there's visibility. So see how your customers experience and how they impact the behind-the-scenes operation, so really what's going on. The visibility is important. Also think about the understanding. So as you said earlier, like the internal communication with sales, for example, collaboration is key. And collaboration is, that's what we're doing with process, that's what you do, should do with engagement models, and what you should do with customer journey maps. Collaborate with your organization. Make them aware how the customer journey looks, because it has impacts on many teams you have in your organization. Then empowerment. Empower all employees to think of the next disruptive idea. Sounds a bit cheesy maybe, but of course that's what it's about, right? And you can only create new and great things when you understand your customers and understand where you're going. So really map out the journey, and that's one of the key things why you should do it. Also agility. Once you have a process set up. So I had a phone call with somebody a few weeks ago where the topic was exactly that, process, customer journey. We were talking about things. And maybe he's here today, he actually told me that they're a very fast-growing company and they're so fast, so talking about a process solution might not make sense at this point because they're just too fast. They change too fast. And I thought in the back of my mind, hey, that's what it's about. That's why you collaborate, that's why you publish something and give it to everyone so that you can be fast. Talk about it, change it, publish it, and then have it constantly moving. And then excellence, of course, once you understand that, you can actually create that journey that's really beneficial for your customers, right? And influence this journey through your processes and through what you're doing so that you can reach actually a process that is actually underlining the customer journey to really make your customers prosper with your solution. So there's some key takeaways I think we can take out of this. So a client journey must be cross-functional. So if a client journey is not cross-functional, you can't succeed. So it starts from the first marketing interaction, as we said before. So you look on a website, you have some interaction, starts there. It goes through onboarding, and it goes all the way through the whole nurturing phase where the customer has interactions with you. Then there's journey, engagement, and process. So we started the other way around. As now we started with a process through the engagement and went to the journey. Typically now, people think about the journey first. Get a great understanding of your client's initiatives through a well-mapped customer journey. And through that, basically engage them seamlessly and bring that knowledge back to come back to your process and improve that, as I have said before. And also be very deliberate about what efforts and client interactions will be technology-led versus human-led, as you mentioned before. So really be sure, okay, where does a human has to interact with somebody, or where can you automate stuff, a thing we're talking a lot about at Pulse, to really be sure what you really need to be doing. And these process models, for example, we talked about before, could be something where you see what could be technology-led, because if it's a repetitive task that could be done by a machine, this process will enable you to do that. And with that, I think we're ready for questions.
So hopefully you've been putting your questions on Slido, either the app or slido.com under Zinc.
Zinc, exactly.
So we'll get to those. All right, so the top question, Stephen, is how do you make sure every professional is informed on the customer issues or actions? How can they speak with one voice?
That's a really good question. So that's, of course, a key question. Whenever you're talking, for example, about customer issues and actions, you're oftentimes talking about things that are collected in certain tools, right? So you're talking probably about a support solution where issues and actions are collected, maybe a feedback, a customer community or something that's taken back to a CRM system. So talking about us, for example, we're making sure that everything is collected in a CRM system. So everyone from sales, customer success, support, consulting, training is aware of which issues you have and actually knows how to handle them, and everybody's aware of that. What helps for that, of course, is if you have mapped out such a journey to really know, okay, at which point can that come up, and then have a process to solve it, of course. But as a tool where that is done, I would see a CRM solution and how to make sure of it, give people access to that data. So share, collaborate, that's, I think, the key.
I'm going to be cheeky and answer a slightly different question. So it's more, how do you make sure that your internal teams are aware of updated processes or what the client journey is? And something a long time ago that I heard was, actually on the sales side, when you're prospecting, it takes approximately 5 to 7 touches before a prospect and or potential lead will pay attention to a message. It's the same thing with internal communications. So when you're putting together a new client journey or sharing it out, you need to make sure that you are actually hitting people over the head with the same message 5 to 7 times, because until you hear someone go like, oh my God, I've heard that, you cannot guarantee, based on all the things that are happening in your business, that it's going to resonate. So slightly different question, but I think it's worthy of sharing.
So next question is, can you both share examples of what inside-out decisions, mistakes have you done and how you did to adjust them for a better customer experience?
Oh boy, many. Actually, not from my current place, but back when I was starting out. So when I was at HubSpot, which was many, many years ago, we were going through our segmentation process, and we thought, oh my gosh, all the small customers, we should put them all together. That's going to be a great experience for them. And it was absolutely deplorable, because the individual responsible for those accounts also had to do renewals and upsell. And they bucketed the whole group together, so it was approximately 2,000 customers, where this one individual had to figure out how to do that. The experience for everyone involved, from customer through to the poor person working with them, was awful and didn't work at all. So we actually needed to pull it apart and think about where we could get economies of scale and where the value of having people involved were. And that's actually part of what started the process of, if you go to that company now, is their academy. So it's an education academy. And it was with so many customers who are a low annual recurring revenue or total account value or whatever metric that you're calling it, whatever value there that's low, we can't just do it with a lot of people. So it was figuring out what could be pulled apart to give them a lot of value and a great experience, but without necessarily just saying, okay, we're going to give one person to 50 of you, because it just didn't work out from a dollar standpoint. So that's my favorite, just because like everybody involved knew it was terrible. The churn went way up. I was stressed out. My manager was stressed out. Everyone was stressed out. So we reverted that after about 5 months.
Awesome example. So I will just add a short one. So basically our onboarding process. So we started our onboarding process from understanding the process and created some. And I think we now have probably the 7th iteration of an onboarding process. So through understanding how customers are actually running through onboarding, of course, we try to improve that onboarding process. So this would be my classic example of going through that and learning that you should actually look how it works for the customer first. So that was a great insight.
Another, because I have lots of funny stories of things that go wrong, so I'm comfortable sharing them. another one company that will remain nameless, we decided we wanted to update the client journey, and we were like, okay, client journey starts before they sign the contract, so we're going to get CSMs involved before contract signing. And again, it was one of those things that in theory, it was like, oh, we're going to introduce the client to their person, they're going to have this beautiful handoff, they're going to have a wonderful experience, we won't have any knowledge loss. And instead, what ended up happening was the CSDs, or CSMs, got totally caught up in the pre-sales process and spent a lot of time with people that never ended up signing, to the detriment of the clients that we had. So that was learning for me. It was, let's really think about what we're trying to do in the sales process and enable that, but maybe enable it in a different way so that clients that are paying are getting the help and guidance that they need in order to adopt and be successful. So another story. I have lots if you want to see me after. next question. So, Steven, did you create a different customer journey for each tier or customer segment?
So, generally speaking, you should. So, customer journeys are typically helpful when they really point on one specific journey. So, for a specific product, for a certain situation, for a certain tier, for example, and, for example, for a certain way they get through your marketing channel, for example. So how were they made aware of your tool? So in general, you would have multiple journeys showing how your customers run through a company to understand specific topics. For example, to talk about with marketing, how they actually were aware of what you're doing. And then speaking about different tiers, of course, then sales and customer success, for example, or training, consulting, whoever's involved, professional services, to really know how to treat those customers. So it's no surprise, or it wouldn't be a surprise when you start with customer journey mapping and you immediately have like 10 customer journeys you're working on. So there will be definitely multiple customer journeys you should be working on. Because think about process, if a process gets too complex, for example, or a model, nobody will look at it, nobody will actually work with it. So there's this KISS principle, so keep it short and simple. And that's specifically important for customer journeys, especially when you share them internally. They need to be understandable, right? So again, coming back to these engagement models and internal communication, these models just can't be too complex and can't show too many abbreviations of a certain path they can take. So a customer journey should show a clear path from a marketing situation, for example, to an issue that is solved. So a clear path through that journey.
I feel like that's a very complete answer.
Thank you very much. That's why you get the next question. So who or which team in the organization should be responsible for mapping the customer journey?
I'm going to say customer success should take ownership of getting the group together to do it, but it has to be cross-functional. Because of the fact that every team at some point will touch the client in some way, even back office finance, because people need to do billing, there's an AR team, so everyone needs to be involved. But customer success, you are the advocate of the client, so you should be the one corralling the group and ensuring that it's continuously being led forward. If we don't take ownership of it, at the end of the day, yes, everyone contributes to the customer experience, but their focus is a little bit different.
Yeah, maybe adding to that, so customer journey mapping is no standard. So there's no standard commission that's telling you how to do a customer journey, right? So some do it very visually, some create text, some mix up the both things. In many companies, the marketing team or a group around that is creating a very fancy customer journey, and then after 2 years, it's finished, and you put it up a wall, it looks very fancy, and everybody thinks, okay, we have a customer journey set, and we're good to go. That's good, at least there is a customer journey. But the customer journey we're talking about here in customer success most of the time, and that's why we're talking about collaboration, sharing it, keeping it simple, actually working with it, it's kind of a little bit different one, because that's one you really want to use operationally. And therefore, customer success is typically the team that had the greatest understanding of how it could work, and then internally work with all the stakeholders to have a great understanding. I think journey mapping, at least from my perspective, you can't really do it well if you're not talking to the people that actually understand it. So you need to talk to sales, you need to talk to marketing, and make them do that. And therefore, I would completely agree that customer success should lead it. In other organizations, we also see that the process teams that are pushing process and making everyone understand that these models help understand issues and actually improve the company from the inside out, they also benefit from the customer journey and therefore take over mapping the customer journey to bring these worlds together. So take the process view, how am I working internally, take the journey view, bringing all that together to get the best understanding.
So the next question we have is, in a global or international organization, which services, tasks should be centralized and which ones should be localized?
That's a really good question. So I think it depends, what you should never say on a stage, I heard. If you're talking about customer success, I think this is what we're doing a lot. We always say that customer success is not customer success. So depending on what product you have, what services you have, what market you're working in, which region you are, the differences are quite significant. So if we're talking about our example, for example, we have a global customer service and customer success organization with teams in the local regions, for example. And there we saw, for example, that for us, it's super important to have a regional marketing, sales, and customer success teams there to actually work with the customers on the ground. And then there are a lot of organizational and back office things, of course, that can be done in headquarters. So if we're talking about really about transactional services and tasks, for us, for example, in customer success, the main thing that is done in our headquarters in Berlin is tech touch. So everything that's tech touch, everything that's automation is done by the operations team in our Berlin office, because you can centralize it well, because you most of the times have one system, you automate these steps, you have the data available, you have everyone in headquarters, you can talk to all the stakeholders and can automate that well. And then everything that's standard and high touch is done in the regions for a more personal touch.
Some of it, I would say, is also go back to, again, when you're thinking about your client journey and the objectives that you're trying to reach, that will help determine some of the things that you feel are necessary in order to get to those objectives. So you might say, we want to make sure that time to value is really short, and to get to time to value involves implementation and you need to be face-to-face with those clients. Well, in which case, that's going to tell you, I need to have localized implementation. So go back to the objectives and sort of use that as a basis to guide some of the decisions. Also, this is something that you will want to reevaluate. I would say probably every 18 months, you'll want to look at it to say, where do I need to put my resources, be them technical or people? There's definitely been an evolution during my time at Bazaar Voice. And even before that, where there were certain things that were done in our head office because we were just starting to get used to that product experience. And when we got to a level where we actually had the right amount of clients and the right amount of market uptake, it was, okay, there's actually a need for this, so let's get that sort of resource within the localized market. And other things we said, you know what, we actually have a great experience. The customer feedback is saying, it's perfectly fine that it's led from afar in one centralized area, so we're going to keep it that way and invest in other spaces where the feedback might not be as great. So there's two things that I would use to help guide the decision.
Awesome, thank you. So another question for you, so I don't feel too forced to advertise. Any tools you can recommend to track customer journey easier, marketing automation, or similar?
Oh, yes, it's not Gainsight. Doing this doesn't help. Definitely, you can use some of those tools. I would actually say don't make it overcomplicated to start. I showed you that really ugly whiteboard. Like, that's a great way to start. You don't have to use something that's expensive. It depends on what your client journey is. If you're looking into tech touch, then tools-wise, there's definitely a number of the vendors that I would encourage you just to go to talk to see if they're of interest to you. Because part of your customer journey might be in-app messaging, of which then there's lots of different technological partners. You may also want to consider using some of the tools like Marketo or Eloqua, which I would say is like, if you're a really big company, HubSpot, et cetera. So it sort of depends on what you're looking to do, but you can get away with quite a bit being on free tools to start. And I would encourage you to start there to work out the kinks before you decide to invest in something, because again, any investment means you're going to choose one thing and not choose another.
I would agree. So what always helps are workshops, like using whiteboards to get a great understanding, a first understanding, if you'd whiteboard or post-its or whatever to get a first understanding of what you're doing. And then, of course, I'm a bit biased, so we're a process management company, and what we're also doing is customer journey mapping in our software. So a shout out to our friends from SAP, for example, who are doing a great job as a customer of mapping from customer journey over process journey over employee journey, basically all journeys they have internally, and share that with all their employees to have a very transparent view of what they're doing. So yeah, I'm real biased there. So use a software as a service tool to map these journeys, share it with every employee in your company, and then everyone has the ability to see what's working and what's not. And then use that to automate, to scan data, and be smarter about what you're doing.
Signavio, you can check them out.
Thank you.
All right, so the next question. Do you think it's critical that the client meets only one focal person, or can it be multiple people?
Meets. Okay. I think it meets only one focal person.
Meets. We can define meets as just define
touch
how
points.
You'd like to answer it.
I think so. Yeah, I think I interpret it as touch points in the sales cycle and handovers probably. So I'm a big fan of account teams. So not really talking about handovers, more talking about like maybe handoffs and collaboration on accounts. So really having customers talk to maybe more an account manager, so we don't differentiate, for example, the sales managers, it's just for new sales and the account managers, so we're talking about account executives and working with the account and kind of stay in the loop for the whole customer lifetime. And then we have the customer success managers that collaborate with sales basically to be the trusted advisor at his side. So knowing the goals of the customers, working with these customers. And then always when it comes back to contractual questions, upsell, cross-sells, bring the sales manager back into the game to talk about them. So this customer success manager typically has more contact with them. So I would say, to keep it short, no. I can say this could be multiple people.
This is actually one, it's an interesting question because we're actually coming across this in some of our more high-touch segments right now. It's a conversation that my managers and I are having where our higher touch segments, because of the fact that they are higher touch, they're saying like, whoa, I feel inundated because you're like giving me way too much love in people. And I think there needs to be a bit of a balance of looking at, can you have multiple people as long as the experience is clear from the customer standpoint, or does it need to be one person? And there's varying ways that I've seen that handled over the course of my time doing CS. Sometimes it's as simple as putting together an email alias, which to the client, they are emailing one alias, like team client at. But on the back end, the internal team, it's like everybody, and there is strict rules of engagement as to who responds and who is responsible for ensuring that somebody responds back to it within 24 hours. So you can use a lot of varying ways to answer this question, but again, it goes back to listen to your clients. If you're getting feedback on NPS or when you're calling them or when you're meeting them and they're like, oh my God, like it's just too much, then you need to sort of step back and say, okay, is this appropriate? And use that as a guide point. Because there have been times where I've thought, this is too much, but the clients have said, like, I love it, and then there's the opposite.
Great, thank you. Oh, that kind of fits perfectly. By the way, so thanks so much for these many questions. Good that we saved some time for that. How do you ensure there's a smooth handover between sales and CS?
We are not there yet, so just being perfectly honest with you. We are working through that process right now. In fact, some of the stuff that you're seeing has actually spurred other work that's going on. And actually, big props to my team, because they've been doing a lot on this, and it's definitely gotten much better over the course of the past couple months. But what we really started to do was, sales wants their customers to be successful, because at the end of the day, a successful customer will talk to other prospects and help them sell, or they will buy more faster. So they have a vested interest in giving us good stuff. And we said to them, like, are you willing to participate? They said yes, and so it was, okay, team that is setting up these customers, so consulting and customer success, what do you need to know in order to actually set up these customers and, again, get to that time to value really short? And so the group has gotten together and said, here's all the information that we need, that we know based on our successful customers, we need you to share with us. And so what we're going to do is we're going to be giving that list to sales management to verify, and once they're comfortable with it, conceptually they're comfortable, but now it's the actual doing. Once they're comfortable with that, they're actually going to institute that at our client handover, the salesperson has to be able to answer those questions. Doesn't mean that they have to write them all down, because let's be honest, we need to meet halfway, but they will bring those answers so we can sit down and run through them all, and then the person that's meeting the customer for the first time on that first kickoff call is able to say, in your sales process, your salesperson told me this and this, and we should talk to this person at the organization. Does that sound like what you told them? It does? Great. So that's part of the process that we're putting in place right now to help correct some of the challenges we're seeing.
Yeah, I am German to a large part, so I like rules a bit, and therefore I like mandatory fields. So when you're talking about handovers, what helps a lot is mandatory fields in Salesforce. So when we were integrating Salesforce, I was a big promoter of actually making every field mandatory. So if the data's not there, it's not good. And also what helps with that is either have the data in mandatory fields, for example, or in your Salesforce, in your CRM system, and then something we call task routing. So make sure that the right person gets the right task through a workflow, through a process, through your CRM, however you want to do that. So make sure they get the task. So once you have the data and the right person has the right task at the right time, you should be good and everybody should be well informed to have a smooth handover. I think nobody's really there yet, but some people are doing it quite well.
All right.
I think we have time for one more question, sorry. So what is the flow of touch points that the client goes through? I think we might be able to skip that. I think we had to put task routing and giving over questions, if I read that right.
I wasn't totally sure how to answer it, so I'm okay with skipping it.
Okay. How do you take cultural differences into account as you plan out interaction and touches? Any best practices dealing with multiple languages and countries?
Patience. and I should, for the record, I like telling people I'm Canadian, so I like to share that. Any best practices? You definitely want to ensure that as you're thinking about the entire experience, because again, client journey starts from your first marketing touch. Think about the languages that you are going out from a marketing standpoint and a sales standpoint and selling with. Because if you're setting up the expectation with clients that you are going to be marketing and selling in the people's native languages, you want to think about, are you also going to service using those languages? And can you fully support the client journey in those languages? And that means educational material, implementation, your knowledge base, live chat. So those are things that you need to really sit down as a management team and think about as you're especially going into new markets. I'm going to pass it over to you just because
yeah, just quick. I also saw that subtle remark that time's up. So maybe shortly adding to that. From a process standpoint, we're talking about process and procedures. So from a global responsibility standpoint, I say process is important that it's a global one. Procedures can be local. So how somebody approaches somebody in a high-touch environment, for example, can be very specific for the French market, for example, for the APAC market. But the process, what in general needs to be done, which activities that should be clear and should be globally set, from my opinion.
Awesome.
And with that, I say thank you, Jennifer.
Thanks so much, everyone. Thanks, Steven.
Thank you.
Our next session will begin in 9 minutes.